to conferences all the time is the main driver for progress in your skill set and also your relationship. And basically, any professional can become a better professional by attending conferences.
It's not the standard, okay? It's a movie theater, but the visual is great and the sound is great. And I've seen a lot of room and space, and I think it's organized well.
Seeing all the people here today and they're excited about stuff. You can see the energy and the desire to learn and do new things.
And I was positively surprised about the depth, the technical depth of the sessions, and how that makes the tester part of the team.
I think developers do benefit from coming to QA conferences, just the same as testers can benefit from going to dev conferences. You know, you've got to have a broad understanding of what's going on.
It's really inclusive, I would say. Like, it's super diverse, people are really, really open and friendly, and it's really organized.
Conferences are well worthwhile for just for the ideas that they spark in people. When people come back to the office, they're full of ideas and they're all energized up.
Hello, I'm Antoine Kouask. I'm French, you have probably guessed from my accent. I live in Portugal since 5 years now and I have 10 years experience in IT. I'm leading an engineering center for Lavedout, a European retail and e-commerce company. My talk will be about constant improvement, system thinking, and how we scaled end-to-end and functional test automation in the last 5 years. Hi to everyone. So welcome to TestCon Europe and for my talk. So we'll share on this successful daily deploys with Rich. And so the main topic we will cover on test automation will be around the functional and automated test. So and I thanks TestCon Europe for the opportunity. And I put Lavedout, which is the company I'm working for. So if I do a brief bio of myself, so I'm working mainly in engineering management, and I'm covering and leading, I would say, engineering team from software and up to the, so from design, development to operation, and that includes testing and testing automation. And this is why so I'm quite involved in that part. So I'm also part of communities such as Meetup and open source. So I'm doing that because I'm convinced that we can always learn faster and better transversally in this fast ecosystem in IT. So and in fact today, I will share so the story that lasts some years in our company to accelerate our deployment and deployment speed and quality on our e-commerce store. And to do that, so I will start by share a bit of context of what was our company, what it is now, and in fact, this will enable me to give you context on where we started in our test and software test automation and where we were up to. So, in fact, Lavedout, it's a retail company that has its roots here. It's more, you see, catalogs from the 1970s. That was on the old, would say, at that time it was working fine for business. It was every 6 months a big catalog that was sent to home, and then that was delivered, etc., with a series of meeting points to the home. Right now, we have changed and evolved the company to a family and lifestyle platform. I will show you briefly what does that mean. So, in fact, we have done a transformation to omnichannel devices, and we have still a lot of work to do on omnichannel management, so to be really transversally with our customer on their journeys and supporting them in their family. But we have the standard, I would say, e-commerce part, mobile app, mobile website, and all that stuff, and specific function as searching by phone or by voice. As a company, we also produce our own product line and line of design. So this is interesting also related to the testing, etc., to say that our company is not a pure IT company in itself. So this is interesting to have in mind. We have also developed new lines of product and services such as furnitures that are also designed and sold by the company right now. And here you can buy what is on this image, for example. And we have also more recently developed a B2B activity. And we have also reopened stores in the last years. And now we have about 50 points of sales between physical stores we own and corners in the big stores. And the important part to have in mind here is, in fact, it means that our customer experience, interaction, etc., have evolved over time. And this means that also our testing strategy have to evolve. And this is what I will share later on our test implementation. So just to have some figures in mind, I think for me it's quite interesting to have that in mind because it enables to, would say, to compare. For example, if you are in a startup, etc., you may not have the same access to the same resource or the same mindset. If you have, you are in an even bigger company, it could be also different. So this is why here, main figures and KPIs, so 750 million sales annual turnover for the company. We are mainly focused in the European market. So it means that, for example, as a constraint for our test, it's more European countries we target. We does not have necessarily, I would say, a Chinese or Japanese character to deal with, etc. And we are 73% internal design are produced from our teams. Quite notable, a known company in France, 99% notoriety. We are one of the top 10 visited websites in France in e-commerce. So it means that our e-commerce activity is quite critical to the business. And so our testing should be quite reliable to keep a consistent and successful digital experience. And as we did a digital transformation, we also increased the sales to more than 96% on the digital channels and 50% on mobile right now. So it means that clearly, any downtime or issue in our customer journey is quickly linked with an issue and a decrease in our turnover, sales profit, etc. We have also transformed the warehouse to an automated warehouse, so meaning that you can order on the site and 2 hours later it's out of our warehouse. And if you are in France, you can have, if you order in the morning, you can have your packet in the afternoon or early morning if you are in South of France. And yeah, so the last point is that we reopened a series of stores and corners to have a coherent customer experience. But that also means that our software and engineering and testing strategy should be omnichannel and representing our customer journey. So it means that we should be able to do multi-path test automation scenarios. So this was to share with you the context of Redoubt. So now I will share a bit what was happening in terms of, I would say, more the IT architecture and context so that we are all in line, so from where we did started. And then I will share on each layer what were our focus and work we had to do and how in each layer we evolved on the testing automation, testing delivery and the software speed. Okay, so we'll go step by step on this. And in fact, on what I will focus is more on this part here. So when we started in 2013, a big transformation program, because we left the holding, because before it's more, we developed the web activity. And the other part, I will go later on this. So in fact, in 2013, when the company left the holding, it was a bit left to itself to transform. And the main transformation we had to do was we need to be capped and transformed to an e-commerce pure player from 60 to 90% of online sales. We had to accelerate our collection cycle times that was still in the old-fashioned model every 6 months. And we had to accelerate it by a factor of 10. So to be able to at least produce 20 catalogs a year for physical catalogs and also produce much more shorter collection on our website. We had the part to accelerate the operational excellence, to accelerate the order processing, to be able to deliver faster to our customer, increase NPS, etc. And we have also to be in capacity to accelerate the internal rhythm of, would say, digital offering and internal business services development, to be able to support iteration on new business models and ideas. And this is what we had to do, like we discover the furniture business or B2B activity. So, and what that means for us in terms of architecture, engineering, and software is that the acceleration of web delivery and performance was a key driver for us to support the acceleration of the e-commerce. And then the other topic were more linked to an architecture that is faster and flexible. And all of this was supported with the test automation strategy I will explain. So we'll start with the first part, which was the main driver at that time, which was the acceleration of the web delivery. So what was our starting point on the left is that our initial state is that we had inherited from two web platforms. So one for France and one for international. So when I say international, it was all non-French website, and that was mainly countries within Europe, including a .com website that is accessible for varieties on countries. So what was happening, in fact, is we were having, would say, the same concept and brand La Redoute, but we were having each time to perform double functional technical specification and coding because the platform were different. So this was not faster and efficient enough for our company to accelerate and save money. So at that time, we had to do a choice of platform. And the French one has been built in New York with all the fancy company, etc., web agency. And the international one was built with a much more startup approach. And here we had to make a choice. Should we go with a French website that probably is maybe more robust and able to cope with more traffic, or try to develop and deploy our international platform on French website? And in fact, what we decided, as we wanted to move to a more, would say, agile, so faster development, we decided to go with our more smaller company. And we did a 9-month project to migrate all our French website to the international platform. And we ended up, after some months, with a mobile site and the main site that were available. And I didn't put it here, but we had also the app. And this enabled us to reach a first step, which was a single implementation of our development. And then we also improved it by moving to the website to a mobile first and 100% responsive to even simplify and have a faster development. But in fact, even if we did all those transformation, in fact, when we move from the initial state to the migration, our state of software delivery was clearly not acceptable. So this is what I will share here. What was happening, and unfortunately, is the issue we have in a lot of companies in software engineering. So we have the traditional software delivery life cycles that go from requirement, design, coding, testing stages, deploy, and operation of the platform. So what was happening is our testing phases were quite slow and bug correction, so about 2 weeks, so mainly due to manual scenarios, etc. They were quite not efficient at finding bugs. So bugs were usually found for new features or really key features by manual testing and by business user in UAT. So it means that then we had to do a new release, rollback, etc. We redeploy correction and we redo all this painful and long cycle of two times 2 weeks. Usually it was not even good because it was always manual testing. The end result was from business ideas and the first ideas of requirement, it easily passed 3 months before we are able to deliver some sort of business value. And as we wanted to accelerate business collection, increase of digital offering, etc., this was clearly not acceptable. So we did an analysis of the issues we are having on this process, around this delivery life cycle and value chain. So clearly, we had slow UAT, mainly due to the fact that we were doing manual tests that were not efficient and finding tests, slow to execute, and also not interesting for the people that were doing them. And also, as they were done by other people than business, they were not sharing a lot on the content of the test that should be performed. And also, the tests were usually so technical and not enough business focused. When we realized this, in fact, we could have we were seeing other symptoms, and this is where, for me, the problem analysis and problem definition is quite important when we want to solve any type of issue is that as we were having slow UAT on these phases, it was also creating big and risky releases, because as the releases were slow, we had the tendency to accumulate a series of change inside the releases. This was making so big and risky release. It was also creating some discussion with developers around we should have branches, feature branch, etc., because I don't want to work with other developers. But then the branches were creating issues with merge and all that type of nightmare you could know. And then due to this issue of big and risky release, we were having also other sort of problems coming out, such as inconsistent environment, branches, etc., code base. The code base become quite complex to manage, understand, and maintain, and keep up to date. And this was creating even more bugs. So it was really a messy situation. And as we look at that, we decided to address what seems for us the root cause and the core issue of slow testing phases. So what we defined as the core principles to reach so smaller and faster release with quality. So we decided to address, as we were doing technical tests and that were manual, we decided to do a first principle of functional test automation. And then to cope with the issue of having big release, we decided to move to a model of trunk-based development in the mindset that what an SVN at the time is now on Git. And then it means that as we wanted to have release trains that go quickly into operation, we needed to keep the flexibility to deactivate features to avoid to do rollback, etc. And also to have the capability to deploy gradually features in the A/B testing mode. So this is why feature flags, A/B testing was the third principle we really focused on. And then to be current with the business is, as we wanted to deliver incremental value, it means that our business team and product teams that were used to deliver things in 3 months and try to put as maximum requirement in a 3 months time frame, we had also to improve gradually the mindset so that people started to deliver features incrementally. So if we see in action, what does that mean? So, and what was the result we expected? So functional test automation, the end result was we should be able to deliver with confidence the user experience we are developing. We should completely automate the boring and repetitive tests. And the test also, so this is not something we had in mind at start, but we discovered on the way that was really a key. It was to invest a lot in the test design for reuse and maintainability. So using a standard page object pattern and other type of model-based testing. On the trunk-based development, the main objective was clearly to limit work in progress and have a faster delivery time, and also an opportunity to remove all the branching complexity we were having. The feature flag, etc., was to be able to decouple deploying from activation and avoid rollback. So if we have an issue, we always move forward and deactivate the features. And the incremental feature was to really move to an incremental value delivery. So what we did, in fact, if we look back at our process, is that we shift left the functional test automation into the requirement. So it means that requirement from the product should also incorporate functional test automation scenario that will be later on designed and implemented. We should also think from the requirement how we will handle feature flag and A/B testing. So that means because we cannot do feature flag for every feature, it's a big mess in the code base after. So we need to really design the feature flags and also the A/B testing capability. And also incremental feature inspect should be synced from the beginning. And then from the development part, we move to a trunk-based development model. So meaning we are not having a branch per environment, etc. We could have feature branch in parallel, etc. But the only source of truth for the development and deployment would be that we build a unique release artifact from the master or trunk branch. And this is the exact same artifact that go from QA to UAT to staging and to production. So then based on this model, we defined the following process. So at 11 a.m., we take everything that is on the trunk on master or branch. that is the source of truth. We build the package. We deploy it in QA, execute all of the tests. If it's okay, we go to UAT. We deploy it there, execute all the set of automated tests, and then we do the daily deploy of the web platform. And in fact, along the way, we execute each time the functional test automation in an automated way in QA and UAT, and we analyze the test and check if they're okay or not. Should we correct or deactivate the feature? And then we go to production. We also execute a set of functional test automation that I will explain in more detail just after. So, and in fact, what was the result we managed to reach? And as you see, it's not a 3 months, a 6 months, or 1 year effort. It was a 5 year effort to reach a real acceleration of our web delivery. But we started really slow at the beginning because we were not really mature in our testing solution, testing process, testing maturity also in the team, in test design, etc., and automation practice. In 2015, it was already quite more robust. And then right now we have even more, we have even 7,000 tests, and they are reflecting our customer journey, because in fact, we have more now a mix of 6,000 tests that are automated on our web platform, and we have 1,000 tests that are on the mobile application. Because in fact, we see a big changes and drive of the mobile app over the website. And in terms of factual result, we have reached 96% successful production deploy. So it means that on all business days during the year, we had only very few days we had to do a rollback or a complete feature deactivation of what was delivered. And in fact, this enabled to have much more incremental business value delivery every day. In fact, and much more confidence to deliver. And if we look at what we apply as a test pyramid, so as a disclaimer, what I would like to say here is that our test pyramid here that I show is not the global test pyramid of the all IT system testing. So this is the test pyramid we apply on the e-commerce platform. And as the e-commerce platform has a much more driver on end-to-end user experience, functional testing, etc., this is for me and for us why it makes sense to reach and to use this pyramid. But for example, on back-office services, codeless, screenless API, etc., it could be and should be much different, in fact. So what were the two main choices we made is would focus on functional testing and unit testing, and all the layer in gray, we will really either not do them or really on a limited scope, so which are exploratory, integration testing, and manual testing. So then if I explain a bit more what was our concept on the two main layers we retained. So functional testing, it was really to focus on am I able to do end-to-end successful customer journeys, and does my component features are working? And so this is where we go back to functional testing automation. And here, why we focus on automation, it was to have fast feedback loop and also tests that do find defects, because if we do them manually, they are quite error prone. And then on the unit testing, it was more an objective to say, we will not test the exhaustivity on the code, on the use case for the unit testing. We will more say, if we're able to do unit testing that are fast, isolated, and stable over time, it means that our architecture of the code is quite maintainable and the modules are done right. But we will not test the exhaustivity on use case on the unit testing. We will more do it on the functional testing part. And also something we worked in terms of responsibilities here, it was that functional testing was a responsibility in terms of requirement and definition from the business and product team, implementation by the QA automation team that at first were on IT teams and moved to the business, and unit testing, responsibilities of more, I would say, technical product manager to define the requirement, etc., or solution architect, and developers to implement the unit testing. So I see there is some question. I will go back on the end. I don't forget. So then what we did on the web performance, which is more linked to the operational part, is that we reuse a set of our tests that we do during the life cycle, and we run them in production on a regular basis to make sure our customer journeys are working fine. So, and they are running for every country. And if we look at some examples, for example, we check that the homepage is available and we do a series of tests, also checking the content quality, the response time, the specific links we have, the specific third party are loaded, etc. And they are running at a high frequency, so every minute or every 5 minutes, depending on the use case, on all the omnichannel experience we are having. And in fact, this enables us, as we have a service level objective of are we able to perform the test and are they okay in terms of response time, to have alerts with our 24/7 teams if any of these tests is failing or becoming slow, slower than expected. So what this enables us to do is first good objective, result was that we improve a lot the business and IT collaboration, because before we were having, for example, problems on the platform we were not seeing from an IT point of view, because we were focusing on IT monitoring, CPU, memory, RAM, etc., and we were not enough customer focused. And this reinforced trust and transparency with the business to say we have a common goal and we have also focused on the customer journeys. It also forced us to have quite a stable test, because those tests are running, as you see, on a very every minute. And if they are not working well, we got an alert even at night. So it was a key driver to have a stable and fast test to execute. And also, as the tests were more focused on the customer journey, it was quite interesting to see that we were able to detect much more faster issues from our customer point of view and detect their easier. So for example, before we were doing deploy at night, now it's during the day, but we are doing deploy at night, but we are not sure if there was particular issue on customer journey. Now, as we have those tests, we at least know that the overall customer journey are working fine after deploy any time of the day on any time frame. And we are also able to replicate and to replay much more easily a customer journey that could be failing. And this is also something that have helped us. For example, sometimes we have a technical issue in a data center where we have a slowness of some, I don't know, switches or whatever. But as we have those tests, we are able to detect that some customer journey can be impacted by specific technical issues. So, and then what we address, yes, on the architecture to support all of that, because for me, it's key that all the pieces, including the organization, are linked here, is that what we manage to do here in terms of KPI, we manage to clearly accelerate the cycle of ideas of delivery. We manage to move from a release every 2 to 4 weeks to releasing every business day. And also, we manage also to accelerate a lot the QA cycle we were having, so to a 2 hours QA that includes testing the automation tests that are run in parallel at scale, plus a series of analysis to see all the tests that are not okay. Should they be rerun, should they be corrected, or is it a real bug or not? So, and in fact, right now, what are our main limiting factors we are having and what we are working on to resolve? It's in fact, we want even to accelerate the rate of business ideas we are doing. And right now, our limiting factor is not the release speed we are having. It's more that we are not able, due to our IT and organizational architecture, to deliver enough ideas in parallel. So this is why we are looking at splitting our existing cross-functional teams to more feature team model. And this will be supported by reactive micro front-end architecture. And why the reactive is to be able to also decouple front-end with the back-end with event. Then on the release part, our current campaign execution is running at 40 to 60 minutes for the 7,000 tests. And what we want to achieve is to have a much more shorter execution time of our campaign. And this is where we are working on using an Elastic testing farm Most probably using Kubernetes technologies that can scale up and down horizontally to be able to shorten this to 5 or 10 minutes, hopefully. And then we are still doing a series of manual test analysis on the tests that are failing. So we are investigating, but here, my personal conviction is that it's not yet really mature, and it's better to invest in test design for now on ML statistics, etc., to say, okay, if this test is broken, what could I correct to have it a bit better? And what we address then on the organizational part, and what I can share with you is, when we started, we were quite, I would say, newbie and with a low maturity in test automation. We were a bit slow to get expertise on testing. So what I would advise here is to, if you think you are starting at a low level on maturity on business and IT side, don't hesitate to take test expertise, because you will save a lot of time in taking right decision in your for your context from the beginning. Another point is that we can quickly want to rush into the tooling and big tooling that will resolve all the problems, etc. But this first can be quite long to implement. And second point is, as you start normally with a low maturity, your process needs to evolve according to your maturity organization and how you find it fits better. So my advice, and from what we have done in terms of tooling, etc., is to say, start with a simple process and a tooling on a set of objectives. You are quick to iterate, and then based on that, increase your process, tooling, etc. over time, but don't try to do the big tooling, etc. maybe that other companies are using, but maybe they have 2-3 years maturity ahead. So this is why for me it makes sense to do that. Then the next point I would say is, when you start to have an automation maturity, etc., for me it's important to have formalized quality ownership within the company. And this is not only a business responsibility or only an IT responsibility. For us, it was quite key to have business and IT quality roles that were defined. And for example, we have a quality owner on the web experience, also in the back office for both business and IT. And also, do recognize that testing is a real activity, because to be direct with you, when we started testing automation in 2013, it was more, okay, we have developers that are not that good, we will put them into testing, and okay, they may do the job. In fact, it was an error. We should have really said, we would need to put people in testing that really want to do testing, and that are motivated to do that, and it's a real career within the company as a software engineer, solution architect, etc. And we need to train them and make them visible as other tracks within the company. So this is what we did, but a bit late for me. And then, in fact, when we start to have a more coherent, I would say, roles within the organization and the center of competencies, for me, this is where you can start to move to a more community of practice mode, where you have some people that can delegate to other teams. And this is what makes sense when you start to scale your team in a feature team mode or this type of work. And this is our current focus, in fact, and it's quite challenging to manage the balance between vertical and horizontal animation at a larger scale. So what are my main takeaways before to take some questions? So is that, yes, test pyramid exists, they are quite good for me, and they enable to have mental models. But for me, you should really analyze them and understand what are the assumptions that are behind the test pyramid to say, are they really, does it make sense in my context? And can I challenge them, in fact? Because if we look, for example, we say automated UI and functional tests, we should not do a lot because they are slow and they are fragile, etc. I could say the contrary, saying, if your functional tests are designed as you do proper unit tests or other type of tests, plus you have a strategy to have a parallel test that are fast, they can be as maintainable as other type of tests that are properly architectured, and they can also be fast to execute. So this is why, for me, it's important to understand what is behind and to decide if it makes sense or not. Because yes, if you say, I will do a functional test UI test automation only using Selenium. Clearly, this will not scale, this will not be accessible to the business, and you will not be able to do proper test design and refactoring and modules. Yes, I agree, you should not do a lot. But this is why, for me, you should really challenge a bit what are the assumptions and define your organization here. And then my second point is that the test pyramid, for me, makes sense in a particular context. So this is why I said that the test pyramid I show in the one we use on our front-end and e-commerce part, but this is not the one we use on the back office, on our API exposition, etc., or even on data processing. So this is why for me, it's a bit like a statistics. It makes no sense to look at an average on a global picture and average or average of average because it's the value will mean nothing. You need to look at your problems by context. So this is why for me, define where it makes more sense to address and what is the context you are looking at. Most probably, depending on your business priorities, you are not able to address everything, so pick one or two priorities. Then for me, inside your context, define, okay, which type of testing makes more sense? For example, if you are doing internal services that will be never exposed outside of your IT system, why doing security testing, even if it's good practice and is a buzzword right now? Maybe it's not the priority. In the contrary, if you are doing web development, mobile app development, and you don't address load tests because sometimes you can have, I don't know, some business peak period, you don't do the security testing, you don't do usability testing, and you don't do, for example, exploratory testing, this could be really bad practice. So this is why, for me, again, the pyramid and the type of test you need to do, for me, it makes sense to analyze this in your context and the particular problem you will have at hand. And once you have defined that, you can answer questions with such as, what will be my integration, data, or environment strategy? So for example, if you say, I will do a smoke testing of my API, probably you don't need a very complex data refresh strategy. On the contrary, if you say, I want to do end-to-end testing on my services, you will then have the question, as I want to do end-to-end testing, it means that I need probably to have coherency of my data between my customers, my product, my reference, etc., between the system. So I should probably address a refresh strategy or at least a test data strategy to have in place for your test to work. So here, my main takeaways I can share with you. Yeah, so for me, yes, look at models, benchmark, what other companies are doing, etc. But in fact, you should for me clearly define what you want to solve in your company on which context and define your test strategy for your objective. And this comes back for me to be clear on what is your starting point. There's no problem of starting a test automation or a testing and quality process within your company. But if it's this point, don't try to apply your best practice for players that have 10 years of experience because it will usually not work. Start slow, iterate fast, etc. So this is for me here key. You don't necessarily copy what you can see as a best practice. My second point is don't rush to implementation. From our part and how we did and we iterate is we invest regularly a series of time in terms of problem definition, value stream analysis, KPI, etc., driven always by data. And this is why it's quite important for me to be able to iterate each time and really increase the core problems we wanted to solve and objective we wanted to reach. If not, we could have ended up trying to optimize some specific silo. Then my third point is testing and quality, etc., it's from far only testing tools topic or only an IT topic. So you need to make emerge mindset within your company to have those roles that emerge. Make understand to the board of director, IT director, etc., that the quality is an imperative if you want to deliver faster and a better user experience and digital services. Until you manage to convince that to the upper level, you will struggle to get sponsor support, budget, money, etc. And you will also have issue, for example, to say, we need to valorize the testing track as engineering, solution architect, or product owner track within our company. So for me, it's a very important point here to address this part of your dynamic. On my 4 points is the limiting factor for me, the main point in the value stream analysis, etc. is you usually don't have time to address everything you will want to. It's the reality. So define the context and objectives that are the main one to solve. And then based on your analysis of your problem, focus exclusively on the limiting factor and verify if your actions are really resolving or improving the issue you are having. And really for me, a key focus is to have fast feedback loops between business ID, development of the coding of the IDs, and testing verification in production and by the user. So focus for me on this feedback loop and value stream to really accelerate your cycle time of delivery. And yes, my last point is a bit the summary of those one is don't be afraid to compose your own tooling, etc. For example, on our side, the testing automation tool we have is the one we have released as open source, is the Cerberus testing. But what I want to say is we didn't copy an existing process or tooling, etc. And also 5 or 6 years ago, the ecosystem was not the same in terms of testing tools. So I would say, really, don't be afraid because your context is different from each company. You have a lot of different company size, profile, skills, context, and dynamic. So honestly, for me, start small in terms of process, people, and tooling. Iterate and verify if you're able to improve your KPI. I would say if you have done correctly the work in research at the beginning, you will have the benchmark and best practice in mind, and you will usually avoid the traditional pitfalls and anti-pattern you should not do. So in fact, this is what I wanted to share. So I will take on some questions right now on the time it left before to move to the Ask Me Anything corner, and you are welcome to go to the Ask Me Anything corner to share. So I will take the question. So if there is one that are more voted, no, yeah, the first one. So do you really need 6,000 steps to know something is broken? So yes, unfortunately, in fact, I can answer is we don't need 7,000 tests to know if a main customer journey is broken, because here we don't have that much. Sorry. But in fact, all the tests we are having are functional tests, and they are verifying specific customer journeys we have on our site. And in fact, they can be quite complex because we have a series of delivery, payment services, and all that stuff that makes that we can quickly have a lot of customer journeys to validate, in fact. And yeah, so in fact, to answer, we don't need that much. But if we want to deliver a successful customer experience, and as we have a top 10 visited website in France, etc., we do have a high traffic. And so we have usually a lot of the scenarios are performed by our customers. So in fact, I would say my answer is yes. It maybe seems a lot, but it's also the result of years of investment. So yeah, I would say to have a first level of validation is not needed, but as we are able to have this and keep them maintainable and fast over time, this is something that is making sense. So second question from Ast, what happens if some of automation test fails before production? Do you still deploy to prod or you stop? Yeah. So in fact, here we have various scenarios. We have a test that fails. So first we do the analysis. We have a set of rerun capabilities that are automated. So in fact, usually the instable tests are recovered by themselves. So here we don't have a problem. If we still have the test that is KO, then we have various possibilities. It's directly shared with the developer, the team responsible for the development. And what happens after is that the developer can fix it, ship to the merge, ship to the trunk or the main branches, and we deliver the application and we run the set of testing. And if this is okay, we'll proceed to the deployment at night. So this is the first scenario. That happens a lot, in fact, because we are able to quite iterate fast on this loop. And then the last scenario, if it's still KO, and we are really not confident to deliver, is that we deactivate the feature when it goes to production. Because in fact, over time, a lot of our features have now always a feature flag activated. So we are able, in fact, to, for the most of them, to be able with the flexibility to deactivate them. And in fact, another scenario that can happen linked to your question is if we didn't saw a test didn't saw a problem in the new release of the application and that we only see in production the bug, etc. Either we deactivate with feature flag if it's available, or we can accept a next delivery the next day. So this happens also. Sometimes it's not that business critical and we prefer to move forward. And last case, we do a rollback of the release, which is part of the 4% case we are not able to deliver properly. This happens sometime. Another question. What is a parallelization solution? Yes, but we use the solution Cerberus testing to do a parallel test execution because this manages the test campaign scheduling and the management. It manages also dependencies between test and the execution sending. And then the testing farm is based for mobile test. We have our untesting farm with about 50 devices. And then for the web part, we use right now a series of internal small VMs with Chrome, Firefox, and all the browser we need. And we also use some browser stack for specific devices we are not having. Yeah. And what we are working right now is to move all of the web tests to a Kubernetes type in the cloud farm to be able to leverage the elasticity and increase by a factor of 10 the time of execution. Okay, then if I see another question. Yeah, but do you focus on covering multi-browser device operating system? Yes, we do focus on them. For example, the 50 device we have is a mix on the, would say, the 80% device our customer is using. So yes, we are doing, and the same for the web testing. We are doing that, and we have issue like a lot of people, I think, on Internet Explorer and all that type of stuff. So hopefully this will disappear soon, but yes, we have still that to manage. Yeah. Okay, then the approach we have to have less flaky tests. Yes, so but in fact, we have people that are responsible for automation. They have objective on the flaky test ratio. We have a test dashboard that enable us to follow the campaign stability and individual test stability ratio. So this is the first step to have measure and to detect the tests that are flaky. And then what are the best practices to have a flaky test? So for me, we have really two practices. First one is a proper test design with reusable step action and controls that are stable over time and reused across tests. So this brings stability and coherency between the tests. And the second one is a really key and a very complex topic. For me, it's complex, is the test data management. Because usually the tests are, for me, they are flaky because either they are badly designed or they don't have the required data or integration between the system. So for me, the test data and integration is a key topic and complex topic because it usually means you need to keep integrated a series of systems. But this is the topic we are addressing, yeah, and it's not easy. So there is a question, yes, stopping us to doing more than release per day. So yes, so one part is what I share on the architecture is in fact it's today we could do more releases per day, but in fact as we are working on 8 hours per day plus we have developers that are in a 1 hour time zone difference with the product team in France, right now we don't have find a working, say, I would say, rhythm that enable us to do more one release per day in the current architecture, which is a main platform with 5 or 6 main components. So in order to accelerate, for me, we should shorten the test execution timings, plus move to a decoupled micro front-end component that will enable us to ship independent features and components. And here, for me, we would have multiple deploys per day in parallel. And this is our big focus right now.